Hey everybody, welcome to Hit or Die Podcast with your hosts Jake Saldotti and Chad Rothford. Episode 150, another milestone, I guess.
Congrats, buddy.
Congrats.
Almost 3 years here.
Oh, at the podcast, yeah. July will be 3 years. July 2nd.
Crazy.
It's been a wild ride.
It's been a journey. 150, that's, hey. Congrats, man. That's,
yeah, you too.
Hey. With you. Go follow the podcast. Instagram, at Hit or Die. Also on Twitter, at Hit or Die Podcast. Please keep going to YouTube and hitting that subscribe button, smashing it. You're never getting that tattoo.
Never getting that tattoo.
It's just not happening.
Sorry, Badge. Andrew Barger is one of our big time supporters. He's a pitcher for us at City, and I told him, I said, dude, you need to help me out, man. You need to get all your boys subscribing on the YouTube channel.
Maybe there's new people listening, and we should... What was the deal?
There aren't new people listening, because...
No, I mean, there is.
Oh, I guess there's new people listening, not on YouTube, but...
The deal was...
So we had Brock Jones on the podcast. It was a great episode, and he has a Fresno tattoo on his arm, and... The deal was if we got to 1,000 subscribers, I would get the Fresno tattoo.
And that was over the summer. And we're not even nibbling.
We're not even halfway there. So.
It's okay.
Yeah. So if you're a new listener and you want to go subscribe to get me that tattoo.
Got a long ways to go.
But go subscribe if you want to watch it. Some of the episodes to watch are really fun, especially when we have guests on and we get to see how they interact with us. So,
sometimes I it's like we recorded one for the, you know, YouTube, and then the minute, you know, 100 people watch it, it's like you have to keep doing it, whether it's 50 or like everybody, because that's what some people that they don't go listen to it.
Yeah.
So you've got to, you know, trying to cater to everybody, I guess.
That's what we do here.
Speaking of the fans, though, we normally, at some point throughout the year, give you an update or top 10 of where, you know, our audience is or where people are listening. It's always fun to go look at. And we haven't done one for 2022 yet. We're 3 months in here. And, well, 2 full months. But since January 1, the top 5 states, and I don't remember what it was last time, but number 5 is Oregon, then Washington, Colorado at 3, Texas at 2, and of course California will normally be at number 1.
Come on, Oklahoma. Where are my Oklahoma peeps at, man?
There are some.
Where are they at?
I don't know if even in the top 10, though, as far as states go. It might be. I got to go look.
Trowbaugh, let's go. I know you're a listener. Let's go. Get all your people on there.
But like Colorado and Texas, like it's not
even... I don't even know if I know anybody in Colorado.
I don't either. I don't know anybody.
Texas, I do.
But it's not even close.
Washington?
Yeah, Washington.
Oregon?
Yeah. I'm just saying. I was surprised too at those. But Texas and Colorado, it's like it's like a big drop off.
Shout out to those guys.
Yeah, and it's like specifically, I even wrote them down. Like in Texas or in, yeah, let's see,
Colorado,
Fort Collins, Inglewood, Loveland, and Denver. Like those guys, they kill it every month.
Yeah,
and then in Texas, it's
John Elway and I were on the phone the other day talking about the Russell Wilson trade. Move, yeah. I had some input on it, so
Do you like that move?
I don't, but...
You don't like that move?
I don't. I mean, I like it for Denver. I just think of him as Seattle. Like, that's your quarterback. Like, for...
But I bet people felt that way with Brett Favre, you know, when he left Green Bay.
Yeah, but there's no backup in Seattle that's the next up-and-coming. Brett Favre had Aaron Rodgers behind him. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So, I don't know. I just feel like, you know, Wilson and Carroll are... You know, like peanut butter and jelly.
They're the duo. They're the...
But Denver, that was a great move for them. You know, they gave up a lot, though.
They did.
They gave up a lot.
They did. But they're also... don't need as much.
I don't know. Do they have the receiving core?
They're young. Depending on what they do with Melvin Gordon, too. You keep Melvin Gordon and you got, you know, Javonte Williams. You got a pretty good backfield. O-line's pretty good. They haven't had a quarterback, so you really don't know.
Since Peyton Manning.
Yeah. And that led to the Super Bowl, yeah. The defense isn't bad. So, I mean, it could be. That's a good division, too.
Mm-hmm.
So. But, oh, yeah, we haven't talked that. We haven't got your opinion on that since you're not out of the fantasy game.
I'm out of the fantasy.
Are you coming back?
No.
You're done with fantasy?
Done with fantasy.
Really?
Yep.
I'm kind of surprised.
Why?
Because it's fun.
I have no time for that.
That's true. Right now, you don't. You don't. Texas. Shout out Texas, specifically Frisco, Tyler, Southlake, Prosper, also Tempe, Dallas, San Antonio, and Houston. Those first handful, though, it's a lot. It's pretty cool. So thank all of you. Not in California. That's pretty awesome.
Yeah.
In California, the top 10 from January. This is from January. Hayward, California, comes in at 10. Chino Hills at 9. Stockton, California, 8. Claremont, 7. Hanford, 6. Visalia, 5. Madera, 4. Sacramento, 3. Clovis, 2. And Fresno, number 1.
Mm-hmm.
And Fresno is the biggest audience we have.
Of course.
Period. Now,
but Sacktown's been in that 3 spot for...
Yeah, they flip between 2 and 3 with Clovis. And it's always, every month's pretty good. So we appreciate all of you
Clovis
guys.
Well, Clovis is hit or miss depending on what we're talking about.
Yeah,
you know?
It's 1 week they don't like us, 1 week they like us.
Or they just don't like us, but they still listen. And
I think Fresno's just starting to
not like us even more.
Yeah, Fresno might be getting into that. Speaking of not liking us, I put out a tweet. So you told me. I wasn't active on Twitter, and you mentioned that the last episode. And I haven't been. I haven't been doing much of it.
Yeah.
I mean, a little bit retweeting stuff here and like time to time, I'd dabble. But I posted a video with some bats on it. Or some swings, guys hitting. And honestly, the first two, because you asked me where I got. I didn't even remember. They were from last week. I don't know who those players were.
Well, the one that walked to first was like supposedly one of the top high school prospects. He's going to UCLA.
Yeah, I don't think I showed that much of the video, though. And then the other one I did. But regardless, I had people messaging us about one bat in particular. And I just thought, well, I'm going to go hear what it sounds versus against, you know, other bats.
Mm-hmm.
Obviously, I know maybe time of day, stadium, environment, things are going to sound different. Of course. But the consensus.
Are they?
I mean.
At the high school level?
I'm trying to.
I mean,
to be,
you don't have thousands of fans screaming and changing the sound and the atmosphere.
Yeah. So there was. I don't know who didn't like it, did like it, who got mad. I know one got mad. But, I mean, I've had a number of coaches that I'm not going to say who, obviously, reach out. And I can tell you that the coaching community, they like that stuff being put on blast. Now, the intent was... Or the purpose of it was bat only. Right? I got put up or tried to get roasted regarding the player. The intention was never to call out any player, any team, or to say that the bat even belonged to the player. And in nowhere in that tweet is it ever mentioned.
Yeah.
In fact, the only people that commented were, I tweeted it to you comment. You tell me. I never even gave what I thought sounded different.
Yeah.
I would never put a kid on blast. We've never done that on here. And it had nothing to do with the player. And as a matter of fact, that I talked to that player that night. At least what the comments were questioning, right? Mm-hmm. And so that player in that video, we reached out. And
he actually reached out to
us. It was a good conversation, and I meant what I said in the comments too. That I'm not going to say his name because I don't want it. I just because it wasn't about him.
Yeah,
You know what I mean? It was never meant to be that. But I meant what I said. He's a good player and really going to help that team win. I want all these kids to be successful. Okay, but it sounded off. And to numerous people, that's all. And that video didn't come from us.
No.
So, you know, that was my thing. But it was never meant to individualize the player. And nowhere in anything that I posted did that happen. I'm sorry that I'm not sorry, I guess. I do not want to hurt the kid reputation. That's not the point. The point is that there's a lot of these out there. That bat could have been anybody's.
Yeah.
No accusations were thrown. I know. Well, you were called an imbecile. How do you?
I wasn't even. I was asleep when this was going on. I got to wake up at 2 o'clock in the morning and go to work. So I wasn't even really on the Twitter post. But yeah, I'm sure I'm an imbecile. I mean.
Well, I wouldn't want to implicate city. You know what I mean? Like, so I made sure that it was, you know, it was known that it was me.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and that's all. But I think the bad thing's widespread.
Oh, everybody has one.
Not everybody. Mostly,
okay. There's a high percentage of teams that have one or players that have them. My thing is I can't stand it. I cannot stand hot bats or rolled bats or, you know, take the cap off and what do they do?
I don't know.
Scrape it.
Oh, they
hollow it out or whatever. Yeah. I can't stand it because, like, I get, like, stealing signs and doing stuff in the game, but you're actually, like, you're doing something that could possibly cause injury to another player with the way the bat comes off the ball. Because as a certain point of velocity off the bat, it's just it's deadly.
That was the reason for it to for the bat change to begin with.
Yeah. Which I like at the junior college level, we actually test bats. So all our bats have stickers on them.
So I've got that privately, obviously. Privately, people are like, well, what about the JUCOs? What about the cities, the Reedleys, the COSs? I'm like, I don't know. Yeah. I know they test at the beginning of the year. This year, the testing's changed.
So we tested it. We're supposed to test three times. We've tested once so far. We're talking about testing in the next week or two. I actually brought it up to Coach Scott because some of our guys, bats break and stuff, you know, and if you get a new bat, you can't use it until it gets tested, you know. So I was trying to tell Coach Scott, hey, we got guys got some new bats, you know. We need to get them tested so we can use them. So hopefully in the next week or two, I really do feel that I think every team at the junior college level should have a bat testing system. We do have the ring that goes down, and if it makes it all the way through, it passes. If it doesn't, it, the barrel's, you know, obviously extended and it doesn't pass. But there's a machine that bounces waves off of the barrel and has them come off to see how hard, you know, the velo off of the barrel. And once it gets to, I think, past 108 or something, it's illegal. And I think every team should have it. And if you need to test a bat, you do it when the opposing team, you're playing the opposing team, so one of their coaches can be a witness. Because I know they test them, they write down the bat, the number, like what it is, the you know, it's a 34 DeMarini velo, or I don't even know what the bats are nowadays. Blah, blah, blah. They write it down, put the sticker on it. And the stickers we use are the triple C double A stickers, so you can't make them or, you know, redo them. So I like the fact that we're testing them because we've even told our guys, like, you know, City in the past has been, you know, people think we have cheater bats or anything like that. And because we win, you know, when teams win, people try to find things that are wrong. You know, Buchanan is a testament of that. You know, they win, and people always try to find out something that is wrong with Buchanan, you know. So Fresno City gets that stigma too. So, you know, testing the bats, we really tell our guys, don't even put an illegal bat in here. If you have one or you use it in practice or whatever, do not put it in this thing. Because Coach Scott goes down with, like, two bags full of bats, you know, and they test all of them. So, and all our bats passed this year. So I can attest that our bats are legal. And, you know, Dylan Lewis is hot right now. You know, people are questioning.
Yeah, people are gonna do. That's what's gonna happen. Like, so, you said with Buchanan, the JUCO thing. Like, I'm sure that it's happened in the past.
Yeah,
I'm sure every school. I'm sure at some point, City, COS, Merced,
my main point is why.
Yeah,
why do you need to tamper the bat?
I don't understand.
That's my only question. Why? Like, that wasn't even a thought in our minds. And I know our bats were different, okay? I know there's the argument of...
Well, they were hot.
I get that, but I didn't have a choice.
Right.
That was the bat I was given.
Well, that was what they had. That's what was available to us.
But you could still do what they do to those bats, too. Imagine doing that with those bats, right? But that wasn't a thought. Like, people just didn't think about rolling the bats. And I think it's been a big thing of slow-pitch softball, you know? People play slow pitch softball, and that's a big thing with rolling bats or whatever. So people know those people that get them done, and they've tried a baseball bat, and it just – I think that's how it's happened. And now it's just so common that people think it's okay. And it's not. It's not okay. Like, what are you going to do when you get to the college level and you don't have that bat anymore? How good are you really going to be? How good are you going to be when you get a wood bat in your hands and you have to play in – professional baseball or go to a pro workout?
You're gonna get exposed.
So why even have that chance to be exposed at that next level?
Well, not only that, listen, there's enough people around here,
they know, and we've heard it, and we've had this conversation with coaches and scouts and everything the last week or so. They already have red flagged guys. They're already flagged, and some of these kids don't even know it. You know,
but where are the kid? You know, again, the kids may be the ones using these bats. And again, I'm not saying that bat is anything.
Yeah.
The only comment was that it just sounded off. That's it.
Mm-hmm.
And again, I've spoke to the kid. One, very classy, handled it like a man, as far as the tweet went. And again, he's a good player. And I really hope he gets everything he gets once out of baseball. And again, we're good. Him and I are good, as far as I'm concerned. And I mean, you have access, and I think you would agree that the kid handled it really well, and it was a positive conversation. So I know what was his name on Twitter? Slater.
Who gives a shit?
Just saying, like, this platform's open.
He's not even worth the time.
If you want to come on and talk about it, I'll have no problem giving you my phone number, and we can come on here and debate it.
That person has no, like, talk about credibility. Like, the dude didn't even play baseball at Bullard. He was a Bullard grad. He's Bullard everything, which is great. Be proud of your alumni. Be proud of you where you went. But if we said that about Buchanan or somebody, he would have jumped on the bandwagon and started going after them as well. Yeah. So, I mean, don't hate. That's why
there's no profit being made here. So don't, I mean, like, if you don't know, just don't speak on things you don't know.
Yeah, I mean.
That's all. You're more than welcome to come on here, by the way. I will gladly, we can gladly talk it out. Hell, if I'm such a scumbag, I went and followed him. I followed, you know, where's the love? You can't follow back. I followed you.
Did he not follow us?
I don't know, but I followed him. I'm not gonna unfollow him either.
Sorry, man. We get unfollowed all the time. People can't handle it.
No, that's kind of the point of all this too. Like, why do people's feelings get hurt? I'm not using the fucking bat.
Yeah.
I didn't swing it. I didn't even take the fucking video. Why? Because I posted it.
It was already posted.
I didn't post it. It was already up there. It had 6,000 views. I'm the asshole. Come on now.
No, I am. I didn't even. Yeah,
it had nothing to do with you. But the term soft rings loudly with this one. As far as I'm concerned, soft. It almost makes me not even want to fucking cover some of this stuff. Really?
I'm with you, man. Like, I'm too busy to cover it.
I know, but I'm just saying, like, I want to go to games. I want to highlight some stuff. It's like, what? Because I'm the one that finally said, here. Like, really?
Yeah. And that's the funny thing about the credibility comment, which is hilarious, is we almost would lose credibility if we didn't comment or
I'm not the bat police.
Do.
I'm not the bat police.
No, we're not.
So don't send me all these videos of fucking bats. But yeah, I mean, I was like, well, that's the first thing I heard when I saw it. And then the next thing you know, I'm like, oh, here's a text with that same clip from like 10 people.
Yeah.
And I'm like, okay, well, you know, let's go hear it versus other stuff.
Yeah.
You know, and again, no accusations.
And I've sent you videos of my guys at the junior college level and the bats, the sounds they make. And they all make a little bit of different sound depending on, you know, what bat it is. But not that.
Yeah. And my, again, I'll repeat it. My intention was to just highlight the bat issue.
It doesn't matter. They're all going to use it still anyways. Everybody's still going to use their bat because I don't know. I'm done with that. I'm not going to say anymore.
Yeah. It's all right. I wanted to clarify.
I got to watch my lips.
Yeah. I just wanted to clarify that because it had nothing to do with the player.
Yeah.
Like, I didn't make it about the player.
No.
Collectively,
this is going on too much.
Yes. And that was the point. So that's all I wanted to make sure people realized. Had nothing to do, like I said, I don't even know whose bat it is.
Yeah, we really don't.
So, then didn't claim it to be anybody's or anything like that. But there is an issue with it, right? And I know last year.
And it's not just here. We're not just trying to call out our area or whatever. It's an issue, period,
everywhere,
across the country.
Everywhere.
I mean, Casey McGee even told us.
Yes,
going on
everywhere.
Where he's at in Tennessee, so.
Everywhere.
Advantages, trying to get an advantage. Just be good. Just be a good player. That's the funny thing, too. I told you this. People are using cheater bats and still aren't as good as we were.
That's why we're changing the game. Right?
Why are we changing the game? That's a good... You said something about that.
I did.
Why are we changing rules to baseball?
You hear this, like, the guys throw harder than they've ever thrown.
Which is true.
They hit balls farther than they've ever hit.
But I've also heard the guns are juiced out of their mind. And I've heard that from
scouts. I don't know how you tamper with that. And you're saying like so if you go to college, the radar that, let's just call it out.
It might say 95, but he's really throwing
hit or die 90, use pitchers 92. Throwing 96. But it's on hit or die use gun. You're saying the hit or die you gun is.
No, I'm saying they're trying to make the game exciting. They're juicing stuff up. I mean.
So what says 99 is probably 96.
I don't know. I can't tell you that. Like, I mean, all I know
you're
is
under the impression that that's what's happening.
That's what, yeah. And I've heard that from people that use the equipment. So, I was also watching Marcus Walden throw a bullpen yesterday, and I don't know if I've been in high school or the JUCO game too long. I was like, bro, you look like you're throwing 98 up there. And I mean, I've faced 98, and I guess I just haven't faced that hard of pitching in that long. He was throwing fuzz, and he sits, you know, 90 to 95 in between there. And his last fastball, I was like, bro, that was like, that looked like 98 miles an hour. Like, but then again, but he throws a heavy ball,
yeah,
you know, yeah. So I don't know. I don't know, but why are we changing the game?
Well, you want me to say it. So,
why?
No, because I told you, that's just my feeling of it. That's all. Like, people say that. It's the best, these are the best athletes.
And there's a valid argument to that.
There is. There really is. But if they are so good, why are we changing the way we play the game? Or if the game, not even they, players, because I can't do what any of them do.
Mm-hmm.
Again, who am I to call these guys out? I can't do what Luplo does. Are you shitting me? No. But the people that are in charge of the game, they're the ones that are changing the game. Why are they changing the game? Why? Why are you making, like, even with Quentin Selma, when he's, you know, he had a routine. He had a way of doing things at Cal. And he gets into minor league ball, and it's like all of a sudden they want to change how he's always done it. What's been successful for him, because this is the kind of ball, or this is the way we do it here in this organ. What, you don't play baseball the way? What's different about the way you do it versus the way they do it? Why do we need bigger bases? For what? You want to encourage more stealing?
Or more replays?
Why? I don't understand.
I mean, you're either fast or you're not. And there's guys that are fast. There's guys that are probably faster than Ricky Henderson that play the game nowadays. But like when we talked to Hefner, you know, the pitching coach for the Mets, when we talked to him, it's not about – he's in scoring position at first, the way baseball is being played. To them, he's in scoring position. There's no need to get thrown out stealing second base. So that's their point of the way the game's being played right now, and what the analytics tell them is he's in scoring position at first base. He doesn't need to have that chance taken getting thrown out. And that's the way it is right now. When it's like, if I was a speed guy, which I'm not, but if I was, I would want to try to steal bases. Like that, you can cause an overthrow. You can cause more stuff to happen trying to steal a base than relying on that guy to hit a home run less than 8% of his at-bats. And I only say less than 8 because the best to do it all the time did it in 8%.
Do you think – so I get that's why they say he's in scoring position. But how many times does that run actually score via home run?
I don't know. That'd be a good
– versus a double play, a force out, a fly out. Mm-hmm. How many times he stranded at first?
I mean, that'd be a good
– more than he scores on a home run?
Oh, yeah.
So who –
so the percentages, right? We talk about playing percentages. Are the percentages really there of him scoring on a home run?
If he's in scoring, you know, I'm just that's what I'm saying. Like it, that's what we're waiting for.
Oh, it doesn't make sense.
It doesn't. I haven't looked a stat up.
We're bunting him over.
Yeah.
Well, now there's one out, but he's on second base. Rather than you hitting into a double play, now there's two outs
and nobody on base.
And nobody on base.
That's what I'm saying.
Like, I know. I'm with you, and that's what's really. And guys we talk to that explain it to us, it's really hard for them to explain it that way because it does seem kind of off.
How many guys do you really see slide step?
None now.
Right? John Lester wouldn't even pick to first base.
No. And guys still didn't steal.
I don't understand. Like you got the committee changing the rules, the pitch clock. we've exhausted some of this stuff, but now it's finally like in writing, these things are happening. Why do we care about shortening the game?
What, 15 minutes?
Who cares?
The people won't, if they really are concerned about the time limit, they won't watch. I don't understand. Like,
there's got to be something
fans,
in the...
having fans at the ballpark for that long, right? You having fans there for that long. One, it could bring in more revenue. Because guess what? Oh, man, we're in the third hour. I need another beer.
When we went to the World Series... Soda. When we went to the World Series, what time did we get down to the ballpark? How long were we in that area that day?
What, like an hour and a half before game time?
We ate lunch there, remember?
Oh, yeah.
We were there for a total of what?
Craig Biggio's place.
Like 9 hours?
Yeah, 2 o'clock to...
We got back at midnight almost.
Yeah. Yeah.
So when people travel to go to a Dodgers game or a Giants, do they get there at game time?
No. Because they want the atmosphere. They want to go to the store and spend $1 million. They want to go to a McCovey restaurant, or if the Giants have... You know what I mean? Like... We wanted to go to Craig Biggio's restaurant.
Yeah.
It's Craig Biggio's restaurant. Yeah. When are we ever going to be there? We wanted to go see batting practice. When are we going to go see a big league batting practice? Let alone in the game one of the World Series. We wanted to go see Dylan Lee, the dude from here, Stephen Vogt. You know what I mean? We wanted to go see, especially as coaches and guys that teach the game of baseball, we wanted to see how the big leaguers do it when nobody's watching, when the cameras aren't rolling. We wanted to see that part of the game.
Or even when everybody's watching. Because I go back to Freddie Freeman, like, everybody's here. You're an MVP. And you're working on like two things. Like you're just working one thing.
Never pulled a ball.
Not even trying to hit the ball of the yard. I mean, some guys are out there flexing, trying to go out of the stadium.
Solaire. He flexed hard.
He did. But some guys
were just... And he flexed hard in the game.
Some guys, like Austin Riley, had a couple rounds. These guys, like...
They're working on
something. I don't care about... So is it for TV? Is it for ads? Is it from per the owners?
I don't know. I just... There's not one time, and I know we're baseball people, right? But normally people that go to the game are baseball people. You're not going to get somebody that goes to the game that doesn't want to be there, I guess, right? I really don't want to be here, but I'm going to come here. Like, I don't understand that, especially at the big league game. But, like, there was not one point of that since, I mean, we showed up at the hotel at 2, got dressed real quick, drove over at, like, 2:25, and left the ballpark at midnight, or got home at midnight. And there was not one point of that time frame where I didn't enjoy or try to indulge in every moment that I was there.
I know a lot of people are like, why? You didn't post a whole bunch of videos. No, because I wasn't
there. I wanted to enjoy it. Wasn't for you guys. No offense.
It was there for me.
When am I ever going to get to a World Series game again?
And to have a guy that's been on the podcast from here, you know, two guys from this area, a Bulldog and Dylan get there. And then let alone being a Braves fan, watch your team play.
And win game one.
And win game one. Like, it was there for me.
Yeah.
We did, you know, we got some
stuff. You guys got our plane ride. And I mean, but we wanted to enjoy it.
Once
we start getting paid for this, we can go freaking do that and videotape it.
Profits start to come in.
Yeah, but I'm not going to go drive, you know, to do something. And I'm not, it's no offense to anybody.
I would love to do it.
I would love to, too.
I would not even care doing it for free.
I would have loved having a big ass camera and like doing the whole entire game, you know, but I wanted to enjoy that, you know.
And I think that's
people
take in the game. There's a reason for it. There's numbers behind it that say not enough people, right? More people watch TV than can go to a game.
Exactly.
So the point is that how do we keep them on the TV?
You don't.
I don't. If you short it 20 minutes.
You can't even keep me on TV.
No. No.
I can't even watch a full game on TV. And that's not because it's on TV. Well, actually, it's just boring. Baseball's boring. It really is. It's freaking the most boring sport in the world. Because there's so much downtime. There's not enough tempo, right? But you can't control tempo with the clock. Or like the way the pitcher's feeling or the way the batter is feeling and needs to step out. Like you can't control that tempo. You can't control the pitcher throwing 8 straight balls and we're just sitting there on defense for a half hour doing nothing. You know what I mean? You can't control that. So I get it. The TV, it's boring. If I want to take a nap, I'll put on a big league game.
But it's not because of the length of time.
It's just baseball. It's the pace of baseball in general. Whether the game's an hour, I'm still out in the first 10 minutes that I want to take a nap.
Bring steroids back. You know what I'm saying? Like, it was exciting. And I who did I talk to? Was it you? Woody? I talked to somebody and it was like...
It wasn't Woody because he's against
it. No, they don't have steroids to fall back on this time. The game doesn't have... Like, back in the 2000s when the game was struggling and all that, these guys started the McGuire stuff, Sosa, the... quote unquote bonds, whatever. See, like they had steroids to fall back on. You don't have that anymore. We banned the shift. We have a guy that hits 200 complaining about hitting because of the shift. That's why he can't hit. That's why he's 200 hitter. And still, I just think that's ridiculous. And again, no way, shape, or form can I do what he does. But there's ways to beat the shift.
Yeah, hit the other way. Drag bunt down the third baseline. But he's the type of player that the organization's telling him you're in scoring position when you're at the plate.
You know, you look at the college game right now.
Love it.
The college game is carrying baseball. Baseball is breathing because of the college game. Mm-hmm. And it's not even been good, some of it. Some of the shit we've seen has been bad.
Yeah.
But all of it's pretty much been entertaining, both the good and the bad.
Yeah.
Right?
It's just because, and I'm not saying that, like, in the pros and stuff, it's this, there's not a love for the game, because there is. There's every one of those minor leaguers and big leaguers love the game and love the game more than anything. But we've talked about the team atmosphere in professional baseball. There's not really a team atmosphere until you get to the big leagues when you're trying to win a World Series. Because everybody in the minors is fighting everybody else. And all, dude, there's just nothing like college baseball. Like, I don't. And that's why the NIL thing really bugs me, is because I think it's taking away that love for the team.
It's
for
turning your it school. Into a kind of a professional.
Yeah. And there's no need for that at the college level.
In college baseball, I don't know how much that's happening.
Hear it a lot.
I'm not sure.
You don't hear it a lot.
I'm sure it is. I'm sure there's guys that could. But right now, like, college baseball's been, like, the Shriner tournament in Texas.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and you see in LSU and Texas and UCLA and Baylor, and you've seen some fun baseball. When you watched that, you know, and I saw somebody else comment on it, not having a radar gun or a strike zone on the TV.
I mean, I always like a radar gun because I like to see who's pumping and.
Well, you can also get an idea of what, like, from the TV. Sometimes it's hard to see what, you know, what pitch is what. Like,
yeah,
you can usually gauge by
speed.
Speed, what, you know? I mean, you can.
And I like the strike zone.
You should be able to tell what, you know, change up and just by the movement of the ball, slider, curveball, fastball, two seam, whatever.
Yeah.
But some people can't, and so that's where maybe the velo would help. Strike zone. I don't know. I didn't notice it. Is what I'm saying. I didn't realize, oh shit, there's I noticed not having a gun, but I didn't notice not having a strike zone.
Yeah. Yeah, I agree. I mean, you don't really notice the strike zone unless it's a close pitch, you know, and then you
some of those I thought the zone was a little wide on some guys there, but you don't have a zone to
yeah, you don't
say whether it's right or wrong.
Plus the angle. Yeah. Some angles are 45 degrees.
Yeah, absolutely,
or,
yeah.
You know, just off a little bit. So you don't, it might look outside to us just by the angle of the camera. But no, I love college baseball. I mean, it's, you know, you even talk to some big leaguers. They might even say the best time they ever had on a baseball field was when they were in college, you know, back when it wasn't a business. It was just me and your bros going out and playing and trying to beat somebody up. Hear it. So, we're at the Brickyard.
Just got a little update as we're podcasting. It looks like the source is telling everybody out there in the world that per ESPN here, MLB and the union have reached a tentative CBA deal. So this is as we're podcasting. So when this comes out, this will all be much more known. The details in it, I'm not sure of. You know, talking about the lockout, I tweeted out and then posted something a week ago about the president of the CBA talking about how the greatest asset the owners had was the players. And while I don't disagree with that completely, I do argue that I think the fans might be the greatest asset.
Well, how do you pay all those players? If there were no fans at any games, would you have the revenue and money to pay the players what you pay them?
No. And that was the kind of the tweet or the post anyways.
Yeah.
And it was not a knock on the players.
No.
Because the players do deserve a fair deal, and they better, hopefully they get what they want out of this.
Mm-hmm.
And I tend to be on the side of the players, right? It wasn't a knock to the players or to say they're not valuable. But without the fans, you know, buying tickets, traveling like we talked about to where they got to go to get to games, buying the hotel rooms, the booze, the food, the gift shops, the TV packages, all of that stuff, the season tickets, the spring training trips, you know, all the jerseys and hats they sell. Like, it's the fans. The fans do all that.
Mm-hmm.
The fans supply the majority of the revenue. I know there's ad revenue, right? I know there's people that invest, companies invest into putting their names on the stadiums and you know, to be on the boards in the game or the scoreboards or signs in the outfield and all that. I get that. But if there ain't nobody there to see those that advertising, what are they investing in? Not going to invest. There's got to be a return on my investment.
Yeah.
And if nobody's seeing my advertising, I'm not going to. If nobody listened to this podcast, nobody would ever invest in this. Because why would I invest in something nobody listens to?
Yeah, we'd still do it though.
Probably. But that's the point. Like, fans fill those seats up and see.
Yeah.
Right? And they see return on that those ad dollars. The TV contracts. Why do I want to invest in the Pac-12 network? Because a lot of people watch Pac-12 athletics. Why does the Longhorns have their own? Because a lot of people care about Texas Longhorns.
I love that station.
You know, everybody, you know, the Mountain West network is not as big.
Nope.
So.
We need to get a Bulldog network.
Without the fans, I'm just saying, without the fans, a lot of this isn't. And the other thing is, and again, no disrespect at all, but players come and go. We've seen careers. We grew up watching Derek Jeter and his career. Baseball's still here. We're still fans, but he's not playing anymore. Greg Maddux, Tony Gwynn, Chipper Jones. The game is still going on beyond them.
Yeah.
Not to say those guys ever felt like they were the reason. You know what I'm saying? I'm just saying the fans keep this game, and the fans are why it is an industry.
Yeah.
And I just thought, you know,
it was a bold statement.
It was a bold statement. And for what they're fighting for, I understand it. And maybe it's out of context. Maybe I took it out of context. You know, that was the quote that was.
It was right because the owners need the players.
Yes.
So, I mean, that's where it was right.
And that's where I think that was what it was referring to.
But the players need the fans.
But I think I've never talked to anybody, and even doing this, that don't absolutely love the fans, that don't know how important it is to have the fans. I don't know any players that disrespect that or think other than that.
Yeah.
I really don't. We talked to Luplo about playing in empty stadiums. There is no recreating the energy that the crowd provides. It can't be done with cardboard cutouts and
stadium
bullshit
noise
in the background.
Yeah.
It's not the same. And in 2020, when they had the playoff atmosphere with fans, guaranteed it was completely different atmosphere and much more electric. I know Loop, I think they had their wild card game, and that was one of the first games that had fans in it, fans back. It makes a difference. You know, it's the fans. You need the fans.
Yeah.
You know, you cannot, you know, I just felt like, you know, maybe in that circumstance he was relating it as between the owners and the players. The owners got to have the players.
Yeah.
You know, and it's a marriage, right? It goes hand in hand. And I just felt like, arguably, like, hey, man, don't leave out the fans. The fans really do make it all happen. Yeah, they're why they, you know, you have something to go watch.
Yeah.
So, and then, you know, those rules changes, you know, banning the shift, and we kind of got into that. I don't know where the game's going. Like I said before, why are we changing it? If it's as good as it's ever been, if the players are as good as they've ever been or more talented, why are we changing it? Why are we making it easier? Your silence is...
I'm speechless.
No answer.
Just people won't like my answer. I don't know. I just.
Are you saying people have not? I could name numerous times where people don't like what you've had to say.
Every podcast.
They don't like to hear what, you know what I mean? And that's the way it is sometimes. People don't want to hear it. Doesn't mean it's not true.
It's just that we're worried. Oh my God. We are worried.
I don't want to get you in trouble.
No, you're not going to get me in trouble. We're too worried about throwing hard and hitting homers. That's what the baseball, that's what baseball is now. That's what it is. How hard do you throw? How far can you hit the ball? How hard do you throw? How far can you hit the ball? How about like,
not that you can hit, right?
Cause exactly.
Cause I was going to tell you that, like, so I know when I played, I don't remember a lot of no hitters being thrown in high school.
No.
And I know back in the late, like 2000, I want to say like Sales and Silva at West, they went like back to back in 1 week, like no hitters. And it was like insane. Like that shit didn't happen.
Yeah.
And they're at the time, I also think they were, they might've been like one of the best teams in the country, if not number one. Mm-hmm. And that was like unheard of, back to back no hitters in this league.
Yeah.
Which it was, it was. Both really good pitchers, by the way. And then a couple years ago, some more, but like even the last 10 years, like we're literally 2 weeks in to high school baseball.
And what about in the big leagues? Wasn't there three in like the first month?
Something like that.
It was like ridiculous.
But even here, there's in 2 weeks.
Yeah.
We have, I think, five or six no hitters. And a handful of games where there's been 15 plus strikeouts. So I don't know where everybody's hitting at, but it's not working.
No.
Something's off. Something's not right with the game. I want to blame travel ball because all they fucking do is play games. It's a game only mentality.
Yeah. I mean, it's just like, I think I said on the last one, there was a tryout for 7U.
Yeah, I think it was the last one.
Like, what? Why aren't we letting those kids play in Little League? What's wrong with Little League?
I mean, I don't know. Maybe some of them aren't very competitive anymore.
But why are they not competitive?
I mean, because of travel ball, probably. You know, and I get that. Listen, it's a double-edged sword.
It is.
And I'm not trying to put down the players. I'm just saying it's kind of ridiculous. You've seen all these no-hitters.
I mean, and it's like when it's just – where are the fundamental video? Like, everybody makes fun of the Tom Lemansky video, right? Whatever
yeah,
it is.
Tom Lemansky, yeah.
But that is how we grew up.
Throwing technique.
That's how we grew up.
And, yeah.
That's field and ground ball, button down, over your belly button, out front.
Goalposts when you throw, stuff like that.
When you hit, stride, load, squish the bug, soft front side on an egg, or you know what I mean? Like, that's how, and everybody's just like making fun of like how mechanical everything is, but like that's how you teach something. You don't play that way in a game. You're not like, oh, right, left, step, down. No, everything's fluid and you go. But to know the mechanics and the fundamentals, that's what we grew up on. We grew up on learning how to make those movements, learning how to hit correctly, learning how to field a baseball correctly, have things adapted into where now fielding a ground ball, you come right to left through it. You don't go at it like we used to. There's a reason for that. It's getting your momentum towards first. And, you know, now we hit, you want to get more on the backside. You want to get into the back hip. So there's more of, you know, the loading into the hip. But guess what? Your stride isn't different than it was in 1900s. Your loading of the hands isn't different in the 1900s. So where is that? The game's evolving into, like you said, just going and playing and like winning. Like, I want a travel ball ring. I want to do this or the travel ball ring. Well, I want to learn how to be a good baseball player because I want a Valley Championship ring, or I want a College World Series ring, or a conference championship ring in college, or a state championship in JUCO, or a World Series ring. Like, I want that ring. You don't, I'm not going to have a bunch of travel ball rings in my closet. I have four rings that I have. That's it. I have four. And those are the only ones that mean anything to me. And it was our NorCal championship ring at City when we got screwed for the state title because we were single elimination.
Yeah.
No, our team does not get beat in double elimination. I don't care what you say.
I didn't
we
say
don't
anything.
We don't get beat twice in double elimination.
I just like how you phrased it.
And then I have my conference championship or my super regional ring at Oral Roberts. And then I have my conference championship ring the next year at Oral Roberts. And then I have my minor league team of the year with the Giants. Those mean so much more to me because that means that I did everything right leading up to that. I played the game right in Little League. I learned how to become a player, learned how to be a baseball player, learned how to be a teammate, learned how to build character, learned how to throw correctly, how to play catch. Playing catch is so lost now.
Well, we just saw a guy steal three bases or score on one pick from first.
Yeah.
Because they don't know how to play
catch. At Division One.
Because of poor catch.
Yeah. I mean, there's no reason that the first baseman shouldn't have caught step. He just flicked it over there, like, and then he threw it over. I mean, it's just, it's bad baseball because nobody's being taught the correct things anymore. And not saying nobody. I shouldn't say that because I'm not generalizing 100% of travel ball and 100% of outside sources and instructors and whatever. But there's a lot more bad than there is good. I will put that. I'll put it that way. There's a lot more bad in this game of baseball than there is good now. And I think a majority out there can agree with that. Base running is bad. Base running is not worked on as much as it used to be. Bunting is terrible. It's almost mute now because we don't see it anymore in the big leagues. So if they don't do it, then why do we have to do it? Well, guess what? In Division I baseball in the first 2 weeks of the season, on bunts, their batting average was .538 on bunts.
LSU walked off a team on a safety squeeze.
Right? So the bunting is still
UCLA,
there.
I'm sorry, UCLA.
The bunting is still there, but we're not teaching it at the younger level, right? It needs to be taught. We need to learn how to bunt. You know how frustrating it is being at Fresno City College and we have guys that can't bunt? At 1 through 9 should be able to bunt when you get to the college level. 1 through 9 in high school should be able to bunt. I don't care who you are. And Coach Scott told this story yesterday, and I remember it just as much as he does because it happened when I was at Fresno City. In my sophomore year, Santa Rosa beat us to go to the state championship. And they were playing – I forget who they were playing for the state championship that year. I want to say Palomar. They beat us. Anyways, bases loaded. Conrad Schmidt. I know him really well because my roommate from college, Jay Calio, was on Santa Rosa's team. Bases loaded, four hitters up. The dude dragged bunts for a base hit on his own because who thinks the four hitter is going to do that? And people are probably thinking, oh, well, he's the four hitter. He could drive in 3 or 4. You know, he's the four hitter. He can do that. But that drag bunt got their dugout absolutely fired up and got the visiting dugout like, oh, shit, what just happened? What just happened right now? The four-hitter drag bunted for a base hit, and they scored a run. Well, before you know it, the inning's over. It's 6-0 in the state championship game. All because the four-hitter wanted to be a teammate and get one. He wanted one.
Score first.
He wanted to score first.
Yeah.
All because of that. They scored 6 and they ended up winning a state championship. And you can ask my roommate, you can ask Conrad Schmidt. He ended up going to the big leagues with the Diamondbacks. Talent wise, no shot they had more talent than the 3 other teams in that Final Four. And I love each and every one of those guys. And they will agree with you. But you know what they had? They had freaking heart, they had grit, and they had fundamentals. Because Coach Neilinger at Santa Rosa instilled that in them because they knew the athletic ability wasn't where most teams were, that they had to do everything correctly. And I'll tell you what, they had some damn good ball players on that team that went a long ways in college baseball and professionally. But it all started with the fundamentals and how to play the game right.
No, I agree, man. And listen, people can question it and get upset and what, I don't care. Like, go look at the trends. Just go look at them. Go look at the numbers. Go look at the injuries with some of these pitchers that are having and how many. Just look at the trends, and maybe you might be a little concerned with where the game's going. How good are some of the players really? What are we teaching? How much are we really helping them? And by turning the other cheek on some things, like the bats, what are we teaching? That's not what I want. You know, I agree with you. I think the game's in a weird spot. But we can, it can be
dude,
fixed.
But like you said, we have these players, these kids are so much more athletic.
Yes.
So much more. Even these high school kids, they are so much more athletic than we were. We didn't weightlift. We didn't do that. We played outside.
Not like
that,
they do
that
now.
That was our thing. These guys train. They're bigger, faster, stronger. But play the game right. Learn the game right. Learn how to play the game. Learn to be a, you want to be a big leaguer? You're not going to be a big leaguer now. It's what you put into it that you hopefully get out of it one day. There's too much of, I'm good. I'm already good. No, you're not. Where are the people telling you you're not? Dude, my dad never once told me how good I was. And I was a pretty fucking good baseball player in this town, in this area. Pretty damn good. Go look at the numbers. Stats don't lie. My dad never once told me how good I was. When he was our hitting coach at Fresno State, he tried so hard to keep his emotions back when I did good because he didn't want people to have that stigma. He's playing because his dad. And I wanted to prove everybody that I was good enough to play even though my dad was the hitting coach. Fortunate enough, it worked out. But he wouldn't even, he treated me like everybody else because he didn't want there to be a difference. He didn't want people to think he was favoring me. So he treated me like everybody else. And I love him for that, you know. And after games, he treated me like everybody else. But once we got in the car and we're headed home or got home for dinner, we had that moment of how happy he was for me. You know what I mean? But he always said, there's somebody bigger, faster, stronger.
Yeah. I mean, sometimes telling a somebody that something they don't want to
hear.
Your
own son.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, your own kid.
Sometimes some constructive criticism is not a bad thing. Sometimes
how you tough
need,
are you?
Sometimes you need to get shook a little bit. You need to get woke up a little bit. You know, I get it with work all the time. You know, and when you feel like you got things under control, it can flip in a dime. And trust me, you never have it figured out. You never do. You know, you should, you know, tell, and it's hard. It's not easy for coaches to tell a player like, hey, man, it's not, we don't want, I don't want to come down on kids.
Yeah.
You know, especially in high school. And then, you know, with all the shit they've had to deal with the last couple of years, it's not easy. But I think, you know, be okay with being told something that you don't want to hear. You know, sometimes you need that. You may not realize it at the moment. It may make you mad. But go home and sleep on it. Or, you know, that night, laying in bed, thinking about it. Visualize it. Put it in perspective.
And I've always said, and the way I coach is I'm pretty upfront. I'm pretty blunt, and I'll tell you how I feel and what I think. And I think that if there's a coach that's willing to tell you the truth, he cares more. He cares more about you and your future and getting you better than a coach that will just let it everything slide and not tell you the truth. And that's just stuck with me, you know, my whole life and how I've been coached. And, you know, Coach Scott's not afraid to tell you the truth either, you know, and I love that about him. Coach Walton was the same. And I just and my pro coaches, trust me, when you get the pro ball, they'll tell you. There's a plane ticket waiting with your name on it. So I feel like being up front and telling him the truth. And I feel like players, even though they'll be mad at the time, they'll respect you more for that, you know. Because then they could take it. I think waiting and being like, oh, man, then finally saying something, that you waited too long. You know, they can't, why didn't you just tell me this, you know, a month ago or something. Right. So.
No, I totally agree with that 100%, man. And you know, maybe we should do more of that. Again, I'm not concerned about people's point of view at me. I mean, some people, if you don't know me, that's fine. I really don't pay mind to it. It's fine. But I know how we did it. You know, and how we've coached, how I've always done it. And most of the people around here actually do a fantastic job. There's a lot of good baseball people in this area, a lot of great baseball coaches. We're fortunate, and these players are fortunate. I know we come off like it's just brash, but a lot of it's true. Again, go look at the trends. Like, it's not great. The game's not in great shape right now, you know. Go watch some college baseball. You'll see some fun stuff. You'll see some different stuff. It's, you know, maybe that's part of it too. Just not enough young guys are watching it. You know, it seems like it's starting to catch on right now and catch some fire. And I, you know, clapping for college baseball. I love it because right now, again, it's carrying the game, and we need it. So go support it. And that's the same with the high school teams, the JUCO teams. Go watch these guys play. I love seeing all the attendance records from across the country. And now I know that there's a tentative agreement. We'll see what happens with Major League Baseball. But I think the college game is turned some people on. So that's awesome. That's what we want. It is a fun game to watch, and it's crazy, man. We reached 150. Congrats again, bud. And you guys got a game tonight. It's Thursday, so good luck to the Rams and all the other JUCO teams playing. I know Chad's not gonna.
What?
No, follow suit there. You're a Ram.
I am a Ram. The Rams. Dude, I want everybody in our league to do good because it makes our league look good.
Yeah, it does.
You know what I mean? I want our league to be competitive.
Yeah, and that goes for the high school stuff. That's like what people always bash the track. Well, you know, the track's been kind of the showcase around here. I know the league in Bakersfield's really good too, and there's a lot of talent. With baseball, it's kind of everywhere. But there's some, you know, years where football and basketball, it's like the track has dominated.
Yeah.
And even in baseball. But it does highlight the area, you know. So whichever league's good at that year, let's, you know, you don't have to love it, but it is a good thing when teams are playing well.
And yeah, and it helps out with seedings.
Sure. You know, and it does attract more attention. And even for tournaments, summer stuff, get bigger teams down here. And it just attracts more focus to the players in the area. You never know who's watching. You never know who's going to make it to see one of your games, you know, whether you're a summer team in high school and you're at a showcase. Or I know that Buchanan has their tournament. You never know who's in the stands.
Yep.
So it does bring people here to watch more baseball to this area. So. Anyways, hope everybody's staying healthy. It is all full swing right now. I'm going to be at the Co Classic Championship game Saturday. So if people want to come yell at me for my tweet, I guess you can. I prefer you don't, though. But Co Classic game Saturday. I don't think we know who's in it just yet. I think Fresno High, if they win today, they're in. I'm not 100% sure what happens if they lose. But baseball's going, man. We'll have to see what goes on with this MLB stuff. Again, thank you, everybody, for listening. We really do appreciate it all over the country. It's pretty awesome. It's fun to go look at that stuff. We really do thank you guys. And that's episode 150, Hit or Die Podcast.
Hit or Die.